You change the world? Start with the change in your pocket. A little change helps fight malaria. Any size gift makes a world of difference. Maybe you can give some change, or maybe you can give more. If you could take a peek through the coin slot, you'd see what a change it makes. What you give on one side of the world makes a difference on the other side, impacting the most vulnerable, children, and whole families. Prevention of malaria with bed nets and better sanitation. Treatment with access to medication and improved medical facilities. Communication of life-saving messages using new technologies. And education to empower communities to fight malaria. Help us raise $75 million for the fight against malaria. 100% of your donation provides benefit on the ground. We're bringing together a global community of giving, partnering with like-minded organizations, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and the Global Fund. Now, bring your local community together with fun, creative events that bring change. Pancake breakfast, lemonade stands, or 5K run-walk events. Stopping malaria takes a united effort. We can all do something, but together, we can do a lot more. Bring change. Make a world of difference. ImagineNoMalaria.org/donate.
Good morning. Welcome to Grace United Methodist Church. We are glad that you have chosen to be in this place this morning as we come together and worship on this beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning. Hopefully you received an order of worship when you came into the door. A few things that I do want to point out to you this morning is if you open up your order of worship, you will see the list of things that are going on in the life of the church just today. Please take note, if you would like special prayer following today's service, you can go to the bridal room, which you go through those doors, take a right, be your second door on the left, and there's our prayer team, and they'll be more than happy to pray with you after worship today. If you're part of the strategic planning committee, please be in the conference room this afternoon at 2:30, finance at 3 o'clock, and church council at 4:15. So if you are a part of any of those committees, please make sure that you are present and accounted for. This coming Wednesday, if you are responsible for charge conference reports, please make sure they are into the office this Wednesday. Also, Wednesdays, we have our dinner and Bible study. Dinner is at 6, Bible study is at 7, and we have a variety of Bible studies going on. We have one going on in here on Wednesday nights, so looking at music, secular music, and how there's a Christian message in it. We started off this past Wednesday, and I think it was a very big success. So we're looking forward to this Wednesday. We'll be looking at a song from the Zac Brown Band. Just to kind of keep that in mind, you can go online to the webpage of the church, go under the education link, and you can find all the information where that you can listen to the song, read the lyrics, read the scripture preparing for Wednesday night, and even questions that will be asked and discussed Wednesday night in here. So please keep that in mind. Please remember next Friday evening, the pregame event and outreach ministry. You can open up your order of worship and see more information about that, the pregame event. Please read all the information there. Miss Kimberly Ashley is in the outreach committee, is helping head this up. Our youth are going to be helping out with the bouncy houses. Kimberly, do need some help setting up tables and chairs, correct? So Kimberly, raise your hand, wave it around, just in case you don't know Kimberly. She's going to need some help with tables and chairs set up next Friday, so please contact her. See her after worship, or you have her email address there in the bulletin. Please help out with that. Also, next Saturday, on the back of your order of worship, you'll see next Saturday a youth community-wide fundraiser event. If you have already purchased a spot for the yard sale, they will be labeled, Lee said, and he appreciates you doing that. And just be here, support the youth, support the community. Anything else? All right. Anything else I need to talk about? The trunk or treat on Wednesday, October 28th. Please don't forget that. Miss Carol, you still need candy donations? Still need candy donations. Always. So if you have not donated candy for the trunk or treat and would like to do so, please have that in to the church office by the 21st, which is this coming Wednesday. Finally, before we stand and join together in the affirmation of faith. I shared this with our Sunday school class this morning, just something to be thinking about. It's a word that's been on my mind this week. It reminds us of who God is and the God that we worship. It's from the Old Testament book of Micah, chapter 7, verse 18, and it says this: Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity? Think about that. Out of all the gods in this world we can claim to worship, out of all the things that are desiring our attention and our focus and our worship, if we're not careful, they'll all become a god, but they're all a god with a little g. There's only one God with a big G, and Prophet Micah said, there is no God like you. So this morning, as we prepare our minds and hearts for worship, I challenge you to think about the God you're worshiping. There is no other God than the God of the universe. Let us stand together and let us remind ourselves of this God that we worship, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, as we come together in reminding ourselves the essential truths of the Christian faith with the Apostles' Creed, words that have been passed down from generation to generation in the life of the church, reminding us of these basics and these essentials of what it is to be a believer in Jesus Christ. Let us join together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
From the depths, from the Let's pray this morning.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be in your house again, God. We thank you for giving us this opportunity to worship, Lord. I pray that we would continue to be open with our hearts and minds this morning as we receive from you, not only through the worship, Lord, but through the message that Jason's going to bring to us, God. Lord, today we are recognizing those who are survivors, those who are warriors, those who are fighting everyday battles, Lord. Maybe some battles that we don't ever have to do or never will understand what's going on in that process, God. But Lord, we just thank you for the healing that you have provided to so many who are here and the healing that you're providing everywhere else, God. Lord, we ask you to be with those that continue to rebuild down in the rest of our state, God. Be with those who are working, who are sacrificing their hours, sacrificing time away from families, Lord. Just protect them and keep them safe. And Lord, as we go through the remainder of this service, Lord, may we keep focused on you and pray as you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen.
Hopefully you noticed a little bit of pink when you came in this place today. Today is our Pink Out Sunday as we honor and remember those who have been affected by breast cancer, as October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And some of you may be thinking, especially if you're guys, like, I would never wear pink. We do look good in pink, don't we? All right, so just a quick word before we take a moment to pass the peace. This past week, I was at the hospital itself, and I had to get on the elevator to go up to the 8th floor to visit someone. Around floor 2 or floor 3, a fella got on. I had a pink shirt on, go figure, because I like to wear pink shirts. But anyway, we're on the elevator, and he just looks at me, and he says, "You must feel pretty manly today wearing that pink." I looked at him, and I said, "I feel manly every day." And he didn't say anything else. But so anyway, just wanted to share that. It really has no value whatsoever. But anyway, greet those around you. Welcome them to Grace.
Thank you.
may be seated. Let us take this time, this opportunity to continue worshiping God with God's tithe and our offering as we have the chance to give back to God a portion of what is already His with His tithe, as we have the chance to go beyond God's tithe to give an offering. We do this for the life of the church, for the ministries and missions of the church. We give so that the Grace United Methodist Church may continue to be a ministry and mission in the community around us, in this state and in this world. That's why we give, and we give also because of God's amazing love that He has given to us. And so we respond back to God's love by giving. And we remember this truth that we are never more like God than when we are giving and forgiving. When we are giving and forgiving. God calls us to be like Him, and He calls us to do those things, to give and to forgive. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we thank You for how much You have given to us. God, even to the things that we take for granted, like the breath we just breathed and the beat of the heart that we just experienced. If it were not for You giving those things, they would not happen. God, for all the good gifts that You bless us with, we pray that we would cheerfully give back to You Your tithe, our offering. We pray Your Holy Spirit will bless it and multiply it. Bless and multiply it so that this church can do more than we've ever imagined in terms of sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with all people. And it's in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
let's all stand as we present God with his tithes and our offerings.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Children are now dismissed to Children's Church.
This morning I'll be reading from 1 Corinthians 13, verse 11 through 12. It reads as follows. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I like happy endings. And when I say I like happy endings, it isn't so much that I imagine a field filled with flowers and deer running through the fields and little children prancing around in a circle dancing. That's not what I mean by happy endings. I think that's a little more of a hopeless romantic, to be honest with you. But I like happy endings. And I think most of society would agree that we like happy endings, because to me, when you think about a happy ending, it's the good guy always wins and the bad guy always get what they deserve. The good guys win, bad guys get what they deserve. And I like to see the good guy win. And I think maybe that's one reason why I always like movies like Spider-Man, Batman, Captain America. Because you have these guys and they devote their lives to good and they win. And I think even in crime dramas that you watch on TV, or maybe even movies, almost always we have the good guy and the good guy comes out on top. The good guy is facing some type of adversity in life, and this main character wins. Against all the adversity, they win. And I think maybe you're like that too. Because again, if you think about crime dramas, at least that come on TV during the week, or even movies, we want the good guy to win. And it's the good guy who spends their life, dedicates their life to helping others, dedicates their life to serving others, for striving for a better world, turning away from evil. And if it's an hour-long drama, usually within that hour, all the world's problems are solved. And everything is good in this chaotic world. And if it's a movie, in a matter of 2 to 3 hours, the good guy has won. He has overcome adversity. And everything is right in this chaotic world. But that's not how real life goes. Even though we want the good guy to win, oftentimes life throws us an open ending. And what I mean by an open ending is that rarely ever do we solve major issues. I mean, watch TV and watch the political debates. They're not going to solve any major issues. And I'm not trying to step on toes, but especially none of the knuckleheads we have running are going to solve any major issues on either political party side. Are they going to solve any major issues? Rarely do we solve injustices in the world that surround us. And many times, again, if we are honest, in the real world, the good guy does not always win. In the real world, oftentimes, there's no reason to why bad things happen. And when we can't find the reason to why bad things happen, it rubs up against us. And it rubs up against life. For the past 2 weeks, we've been in the book of Job, the Old Testament book of Job. And if you're familiar with the story, then you know probably most like everyone who is at least halfway familiar with the story, we tend to focus on the first two chapters of the book of Job. When you have Job, who is this righteous man, and he is obedient to God, and he serves everyone, he loves everyone. In fact, Scripture declares him as a righteous man. There was no other like him during that time. He was rich beyond measure. And all of a sudden, he loses everything. He loses his 10 children. He loses his possessions. He's down to everything, and his wife looks at him and says, "Curse God and die." We're familiar with that part of Job. Last week we talked some about Job's friends and how oftentimes we humans react and are not the friends we need to be because we try to understand and try to find a reason for suffering. And sometimes there's just no reason that can and no logical understanding for suffering. And oftentimes the best thing that we can do as friends is not try to offer the answer, but just to be with someone and suffer with them and go through it with them. And to keep on asking God, even though God may not answer us when we ask God, keep on asking God, because in our asking God, it keeps open that line of communication. And so if you're familiar with the story of Job, he is the good guy, and he is not winning at all. In fact, if you know the story of Job, you may think this guy will never come out on top. And again, to remind us of the view of life that Job and his friends hold, their view of life is, if I do good, then good things will happen to me. If I'm a good person, then I deserve for good things to happen for me. But all this is not really functioning that way right now for Job. It has up to this point in Job's life, but for now, Job finds himself having lost everything. And now Job wants to know why this system seems to have broken down. And in deeper terms, like we talked about last week, Job wants to know, God, why aren't you doing your job? I've held up my part. I've been good. I've been righteous. I've done what I've needed to do. I've treated people the way I want to be treated. I've honored you, God. I've offered sacrifices to you, God. I've done everything I know to do. Even when my wife said, curse you and die, I didn't do it, God. And now it seems like you're not doing your job. I've been doing mine. What's your job looking like? And Job's friends, they continue to try to tell Job, Job, maybe you're not as perfect as you think you are for all this bad stuff to be happening to you. You must have failed somewhere along the way. You must have some unrepentant sin in your life. That's the reason why all this junk is happening in your life. But sometimes bad things happen, and there is no good reason or logical understanding. And sometimes, no matter how much we ask God, maybe we're only going to receive this answer. Big God, little me. Big God, little me. Or to put it another way, this may rub up against you too. God is God, and you are not. That's your takeaway point for today. That's what I want you thinking as you leave this place today. God is God, and you are not. And for some of us, that might rub us the wrong way. And if it's not yet, wait till we get through today. It still might be kind of giving you that in the side. But again, all this stuff has happened in Job's life, and all these catastrophic events in Job's life, they're leaving Job to believe that the world at its foundation is somewhat random and chaotic. And maybe, just maybe, I've trusted in you, God, but maybe, no one really has the reins or the wheel after all. Because I've been praying and you haven't answered, God. But here's something for us to consider, church. In this world that we live in, it's a tension to try to balance these two aspects together. That the world is orderly. And that sometimes tragedy does not have a reason. The world is orderly. There is some control. And sometimes tragedy does not have a reason. So last week we heard some of the complaints that Job was bringing to God. And today we pick up with God's answer. What does God have to say? He's listened to Job. Even though he has not completely answered him, he has listened. And today we hear God's answer. And as we read, I invite you to remember, big God, little me. Hear the Lord's answer to Job. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? What a way to start in your answer. Just like God, you ask me a question, I'll answer it with a question. Who do you think you are to darken my counsel? Who do you think you are to come to me demanding all this stuff? Because you don't have the knowledge that I have. And so he tells Job, verse 3, gird up your loins like a man. In other words, put your big boy britches on. It's about to get real. Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy. Skip over to verse 34. Can you lift up your voice to the clouds so that a flood of waters may cover you? Can you send forth lightning so that they may go and say to you, here we are? Who has put wisdom in the inward parts or given understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to number the clouds or who can tilt the water skins of the heavens when the dust runs into a mass and the clods cling together? Can you hunt the prey for the lion or satisfy the appetite of the young lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in their coverts? Who provides for the raven its prey when its young ones cry to God and wander about for lack of food? Maybe you're wondering why we skip verses 8 through 33. You can read those when you get home. It's simply more questions from God to Job. Where were you? Where were you? Who takes care of the animals? Who provides for them? Where were you? What were you doing? But did you notice how God responds? God responds with questions to Job. And God does not even address Job's situation. God does not even address Job's questions about justice, because Job's been asking God, God, this ain't right. Why are you letting this happen? And God don't even go there. In fact, God don't even acknowledge Job's suffering. Instead, God takes Job on a whirlwind tour of the cosmos. He begins by talking about the foundation of the earth and the birth of the sea. And again, if you keep on throughout the chapter, he begins to remind Job of all the animals that he had created, both these fierce and these untamed animals. And in other words, God takes Job where the wild things are. You think you've experienced life. You think you have understanding. You have no understanding of who I am and what I do. It's big God and little you, Job. And these speeches of God at the end of this book, they maybe leave us feeling a little dissatisfied. They might leave us feeling even a little frustrated. Because we want, if you remember the beginning, chapters 1 and 2, there's somewhat of a little wager going on between God and the Satan, the accuser. Maybe we would like to hear God address that to Job. All right, I got to be real with you, Job. There was this little wager between me and the accuser. And I said that you won't sin against me. He can take everything from you. Just don't take your life. God don't even address that. God don't even go there. God doesn't even apologize for all this stuff to happening. I mean, at the least, God put your arms around Job and say, Job, I'm sorry, buddy. He don't even do that. He doesn't even go there. We want God in this story to at least be comforting. Rather, what we hear are words similar to this, because I'm God, that's why. Or maybe if you ask the question why a lot when you were a child or a teenager, you heard your parents say something kind of similar, because I said so, that's why. And really, this is not the answer that Job or we expect from God. God's words introduce us to a world, to creation, to creatures, and a God that's much bigger than our lives and our situations. And in essence, God is reminding Job, you are only, Job, you are only a very small part of humanity in this world. In fact, Job, you are a very small part of my entire creation. It's big God and little you, Job. God is God and you're not, Job. Which makes me beg the question for us, church. Whose glory are you trying to live for anyway? Think about it. Whose glory are you trying to live for anyway? Because we were not created to live for our own glory. And to be honest with you about myself, my glory is not worth living for at all. And to put it to you another way, if I were to leave this earth today, in 20 years, Jason Wilson will be forgotten about. Whose glory are you living for anyway? See, God answers Job with more questions, and God is in essence saying to Job again, this world I've created is not just for human beings, Job. And think about this, Job, neither is it entirely safe for human beings. And in a very conventional sense, these words aren't very comforting. And if God were to have to take a modern-day pastoral counseling class, he would fail. And before we come down too hard on God and say, God, this isn't fair, let's think about what God does to Job in this scenario. These questions of God wake Job up. These questions of God remind Job who God is and who he is not. These questions from God move Job out of an endless cycle of grief. These questions from God move Job out of an endless cycle of thinking about me and that here's me and the world revolves around me. Because again, church, if we're not honest, our tendency as humans, when we are going through transition, when we're going through grief, when we're going through tough times, our tendency as human beings is to look inwardly and say, oh, woe is me. And we begin to feel sorry for ourselves. And we begin to think we're being punished. And so maybe we too, like Job, need to realize that there's a big God and there's a little me. And when we find ourselves turning inwardly, maybe we do need to do more turning outwardly and turning more to God instead of turning to just each other all the time, because we have a God who understands us more than we could ever realize. And when we feel that all hope is lost, there's a God who says, I'm bigger than your life and your situations and your circumstances and your hopelessness, and I will give you what you need when you need it. Big God, little you, God is God, you are not. We have a God that is bigger than our problems, our suffering, our situations, and our lives. We have a, think about this, church, we have a big God who's calling the little us's to be in relationship with him, even when this life is chaotic and make no sense. God calls us, little old us, to be in relationship with big old God, because God is God and you are not. So what does all this have to do with Job's situation and Job's suffering? Again, Job had gotten to the point where he considered himself in a way to be the center of the universe, because he began to pose questions to God like, God, I've done all this stuff right. Where are you? God, I've been faithful to you. Where are you? You won't even answer me? God's like, you want me to answer you? Seriously. Now maybe you're thinking, so what? What does that mean for me? What can we learn or take away from God's answer to Job? It's not that God was being a smart aleck or God was being mean. God was just reminding Job of who he was and who he is and who he will always be. But if I can, I would like to summarize this statement from God back to Job in this way. In essence, God replies to Job with questions that ultimately say to Job, I've got this, buddy. I've got this. I'm not trying to minimize what you've gone through, Job. I'm not trying to minimize your suffering. I'm not trying to do any of that. I'm not trying to make you think that I love you any less. I'm not trying to make you think that I have not been there with you. I'm not trying to make you think that I am just here to comfort you, but I want you to remember who I am and what I've done, Job. I've got this, buddy. It's kind of like when we, and I'm not trying to put these scenarios into the same amount of suffering that Job experienced, but oftentimes we really forget what true suffering is like. For some of us, it may be that flat tire we see and say, oh God, what did I do wrong now? You're trying to punish me. I'm late for my meeting. Or we go out and the car won't turn over. And the car won't crank. We'll think, the devil's after me now? No, the battery's just dead. The devil ain't after you. Or we miss a meeting. Or we oversleep, and we're late for work, and a boss writes us up. I've done all this stuff right. I've been consistent to you, God. Where are you? And God says, I got this, buddy. I've got this. And I think when God's asking Job all these questions, I think God is also putting it this way. I'm aware of your issues, Job, and I'm aware of you. Do you really think you are the center of the universe just because you've done and continue to do all these right things? Do you think you're owed something for that, Job? Are you living for your own glory? Or are you living for my glory, Job? Remember, I'm a big God and you're a little you. And Job, you're not the only person in this world that's suffering right now. Job, you're not the only person in this world with problems right now. God, you're not the only person in the world that is struggling right now. And Job, I don't want you to think that I'm so preoccupied with everything else that I can't take care of you. But Job, let me ask you a question. Who do you think's been taking care of you during this whole time anyway? Who do you think's been taking care of all creation when you've been going through this, Job? Who do you think's been in the midst of everything when it seems like all hell has broken loose on you, Job? It's me. Because where were you when the foundations of the earth were laid? And as I said last week, it's good to remind ourselves again this week. Job, your panic does not panic God. He's there. He is there. And the way God questions Job is he's presenting this thing, just because you do good, don't expect good to always happen to you. Because neither your friends or you understand how I work, God would say. Because your life is not based upon reward and punishment. Sometimes bad things just happen and there is no legitimate reason. And sometimes you won't even see on this side of the earth. As you heard read from 1 Corinthians this morning, chapter 13, sometimes we still think like children. Sometimes, all the time, until we reach the other side, we're going to have limited sight because we can't see the greater things of creation. As the Apostle Paul said, now I see dimly, but when I see you face to face, I will see it clearly. God is God. You are not. As God is wrapping up his answers to Job, it's almost like God is saying, Job, don't forget. Do not forget. Life is mysterious. Life is strange. And life is wondrous. And just because tragedy happens, Job, does not mean I have abandoned you. You're not the only one to experience tragedy, Job. But I walk through it with you. I'm God and you're not, Job. So church, I would suggest this a little humbling. A little humbling to begin to realize how small we are in this great story of God's. It's humbling to realize that no matter what you may think when you came into this place, you're not the center of the universe. Maybe it's even more humbling to know that big God has invited all little us's to be a part of God's great story. So Job, God is God and you are not. Jason, God is God and you are not. Church, God is God and you are not. To ask it another way, whose glory are you living for? Think about that. So we can be like Job when we face struggles. We can turn inward, which is the tendency that we have, or we can turn outward. We can turn to God. We can turn to continue to love and serve others. When things don't make sense, we still do what God would have us to do. Because God is God and you're not. And whose glory are you living for? And again, if you're going through tough times, don't let this mean that this is not a reason to continue to ask God. But just be reminded who God is and who you're not. And God will never leave you. He's right there in the midst with you. Big God, little me. And our lives were created for the glory of God. Let us pray. God, may this morning as we leave this place, as we consider the words from the book of Job, may we consider how our lives are bringing you glory. In the good times and in the bad, how are we bringing you glory? In all that we go through, How are we pointing people to you? As life throws us curveballs, as we go through transitions, as we go through struggles, as things just don't make sense, as things happen that we just don't like, how are we bringing you glory? And may we not be so inwardly focused that we miss opportunity for the world to see the goodness of you in our lives. May we not become so wrapped up in ourselves that we forget about those down the street who are living in hell and who are on their way to hell and are looking for hope to be found in you. May our lives be about the glory of you, because you are God and we are not.
Let's all stand as we sing, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." Thank you.
God is big and God is bigger than our problems, our struggles in this life. So as we go today, let us go in the hope that we have a God who is able, a God who is willing, a God who is all-powerful. May God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit go with you from this place today. As we declare to this world whose glory we live for, may it be God's and only God's. Amen.
Let's all join hands in unity as we remember to glorify God together as the body of Christ.